You're listening to the Clean Comedy Podcast with James Creviston and Luke LaCoy.
Hey, everybody, it's James. Welcome to the Clean Comedy Podcast. Today, I am here with my co-host, Mr. Luke LaCoy.
Hello, hello.
Hello. And if you notice, if you're watching this on YouTube, you'll see that Luke and I have new backgrounds. I think, well, yours is new for the last couple episodes, right, Luke?
No, this has been my usual, but thanks for noticing.
Yeah, you're very perceptive, James. Bad job. I have a new logo. I went on Fiverr and I found somebody who would do logos. So if you're looking for logos, if you're looking for somebody to come and do a logo for your Zoom, this guy does great stuff. I'll give you the reference and stuff. I don't get paid off of it, so I'm not making any money here. But I always enjoy when I find somebody new who will do something for me because, you know, I'm lazy, first of all. And also, I don't want to ask Luke to do a million things. It just seems like the wrong thing to do, right, Luke?
Yes.
So today, you guys are in for a special treat because we have a lot of Southern charm coming your way. This lady is hilarious. She's smart. She's funny. She brings hope. She can sing. She can do so many things. I'm so excited about this. So please welcome our guest today, Jane Jenkins Herlong, as in her long hair.
Hey guys, thanks for having me. This is great.
Yes, thank you for being on. Thank you so much for joining us. I am so excited. So kind of give everybody a background of who you are and maybe a little bit of how you got started in comedy and public speaking and those, because you do a lot of stuff, not just comedy, but you do public speaking. You do a lot of events for charities and big deal. Just talk. I'm very excited about this. So give us kind of a little background there.
Well, I tell you, I think we all have in our past, like a parent or somebody who was funny, you know, so they kind of maybe lit the fuse a little bit. But as it turned out, I started out as a pageant girl, an ugly pageant girl, I might add. But
is that even possible? Is that possible?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. They're getting worse. Believe me. You see Miss America lately. God bless them. I mean, I'm going, what? But anyway, probably shouldn't have said that, but I did it anyway. So I started out looking at the Miss America system. And I mean, I was just this little poor little thing, lost my teeth, you know, and tomboy and the whole deal, and wanted to be in a little beauty pageant, little Miss Merry Christmas. I got laughed at, but I don't know what the heck, what that did to me. I guess it made me more determined. So I ended up 15 years later being Miss Charleston, then Miss South Carolina and Miss America. And then I married Prince Charming, of course. You know, beauty queens have to marry a prince.
Right.
You know, that's the way it works. And he brought me to this very, very small town. And I'm sitting around thinking, what the heck am I going to do? Because I got fired from teaching and because I'm dyslexic and all that. And so anyway, I ended up, when I was just here, I had a cousin who just put an ID. He said, why don't you do programs for schools? And I was a singer and I was off the queen year and I thought, I'm going to do that. So, you know, people kind of tell you like, oh, that was funny. I started out singing in churches and stuff like that. And then doing the schools, and people would say, well, golly, that was funny. I said, what was funny? And then you sort of listen to people kind of guide you. And then people say, have you written a book? And I went, write a book. I got an F in college. So it just kind of metastasized, I guess the best way to say it. And then to the Sirius XM platform, I'm on 97, which, thank you, so happy to be on 97. But anyway, so that just led to other things and speaking. And I've had a ball, of course, speaking sort of shut down, but I did speak today in person, which was great. Had a lot of fun.
Nice. So what is your, what made you start doing that? I mean, I know you were doing the shows and you started doing singing and local things, but what made you say, because that'd be scary to be like, yeah, I'm just going to start doing public speaking. I'm going to start doing, you know, shows. Like, what kind of really gave you that energy or that idea to do it? Because that's kind of a scary thing to jump into.
Money. I got paid. And then I realized that I could leave the world of schools and join the National Speakers Association. And I learned how to market to associations and corporate folks. And gosh, they pay. I mean, all you got to do is take your little funny stuff and make a life lesson out of it. And you got a speech and you got a nice fee.
Well, there you go.
Make more money than singing. you know? So I thought, well, I can do that.
There you go, Luke. That's what we need to do. We need to turn our comedy into some speaking stuff and do that. That sounds fun.
Yeah.
I've got friends that did stand up forever. And then they came over to the National Speakers Association and they've just been killing it. I'm telling you, I'm making a lot of money, like 20 grand a speech. I mean, people can make some big bucks.
Wow. And Luke plays guitar, so he could write songs and sing stuff too. And he wouldn't have to like get an accompaniment or anything like that. So is that something that they as well?
So Luke, you're from Nashville, right?
Oh, of course.
he's Canadian, actually.
Well, I mean, I've got a speaker friend who's a songwriter and singer. He writes parodies. So funny. And he's a fabulous speaker. Really great guy.
What before the lockdown and everything shut down, was this a yearly meeting for the Speakers Association? Because I had heard of like some sort of annual meeting. Is this what you're talking about or is that something else? Oh, yeah, cool.
We had a winter workshop in Atlanta. I don't think people are quite ready to venture out yet. It was not well attended like we would had hoped it would be. Mm-hmm. But our last meeting was in Phoenix, big convention, and we get to hear some incredible people. And so it's just been a real game changer for me to go from speaking in schools, which I love. It's a good platform because it really teaches you how to handle a crowd, even though they're little, you know, they can be unruly. So it was a good springboard for me. So I really have enjoyed it.
So what's your process for doing speeches like that? Do you have to, does like somebody contact you and say, hey, Jane, I'd like you to speak about hope. And then you have to like write a new thing, or do you have certain topics that you always speak about so you kind of have funny speeches already written for that stuff? How does that work?
By chance, did you all see the Jerry Seinfeld special?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so at the very end, he had nothing but papers down a street.
Right.
All these stories. And that's really what I do. I write a newsletter every other week. I'm an author. I've just turned in my fifth book. It's called Sweet Tea Secrets from the Deep Fried South. It's just trash, let me tell you. But it's good trash, but it's not. It's clean trash. Is there such a thing as clean trash? It's funny.
Yeah.
And so it's just a lot of fun. I joke about that. But so I just think now, okay, like today I did a healthcare group. So I have healthcare bits.
Okay.
I have long health. See, I'm a humorist. Right. So different from a comedian, we have stories that maybe have stories within stories or a life lesson. And, you know, I have a humor coach and it helps me a lot. You know, he'll just say, no, that's not a good one, James. So I got two new stories this past week. And, you know, we love stories.
Yeah.
And so I'm trying to see. And I told one today, nobody laughed. And, you know, it makes me laugh harder. You know, that didn't work. Okay, let's work on that a little bit. But it is weird. The story was totally weird, but I love the story. So anyway, you just keep working on material and throwing it out there. And I have a task cam where I record everything and I listen to it to see if it'll work, you know, what kind of response I get. And the best thing to do is after you speak, you go in the bathroom and you don't throw up or anything. You lift your legs up out of the stall and you listen to what people say about you. I love that story, or that was lame. And you go, well, let me work on this a little bit more. That's what a lot of people do, a lot of speakers.
I've never heard that. I'm going to do that at the club next time after I get off stage. Go sit in the bathroom, put my legs up.
Don't do it in the portal. I mean, in the little portalette thing or porty potty, whatever y'all call it. You got to get in a stall. There's just comedy is everywhere. You just got to look for, you know, I know y'all same thing, James, Luke, y'all see it and you play with it and then you rewrite it and nobody recognizes it, but it's funny.
Yeah. Well, what I love is that you record it and then listen back to it to see what worked and what didn't work. And then you go back and rewrite it. That's what we preach to comedians all the time is you should be recording all your sets so that you can go back and say, hey, this setup didn't work or this punchline didn't work or this tag didn't work, whatever it was. And then you go back and kind of fix it. But a lot of comedians say, oh, remember when I got off stage. No, you won't. You won't remember any of that stuff. You won't. No. It'll all be a blur, right?
And then you can repurpose that stuff. You know, you can digitally upload it. You can send it to Fiverr or Upwork or someplace like that. And you can get it polished. And then it'll be, you know, throw it up on the web and see if somebody wants to buy it or, you know, put it on, you know, iTunes or Pandora. And hopefully, you know, maybe if Sirius picks it up and that's good. So, you know, you just try to figure out. So then you can write it. and you can record it in a video and throw it on YouTube, or I put it in newsletters. So you just learn to repurpose.
Now, you wrote 5 books. How long does it take you to write each book? And do you go in like, this is the theme for this book, and then you start writing stories that way? Or do the stories kind of come to you and then you try to figure out how to get them to work in different books? And maybe you have like a story that you've had for 5 years or something that you've never put in a book. Like, how does it work?
Well, I really think of the title of a book first. I'll show you one.
Okay.
This was probably my best contract, and this is called Rhinestones on My Flip-Flops.
I like it.
So this book is about iconic biblical women and their flip-flops. And then I have a sparkle and shine moment after every story, like deceived Eve, you know, domestic diva Martha, that would be me. Yeah. And so it's got really, and then Queen Esther, who I want to be.
Yeah.
So that's pretty good. And then this is really bad to say, but when my mother was very, very sick, she said this to me: "Bury me with my pearls." And I thought, well, I really want to have those pearls in that casket. You know, bury me with the viewing and of the pearls. So then I start. Then my sister had breast cancer. I'm talking about tragedies. And then I wrote this one called "What Tatas Teach Us."
Right.
Yeah. So I do that for breast cancer awareness stuff. And so I think of the title, and then I start pulling the stories and think, oh, this go there, that go there. So I got all my edits a couple of days ago, and it was really kind of neat because she really liked it like it was, just a little. So that's rare, because you're going, oh, I got so much work to do, but I still work really hard on those books. And at the end of my Sweet Tea book, now it's going to be a gift book, and it's through Tyndall House Publishing. And then it's going to have like a sweet tea moment, you know, when it's appropriate, because sometimes it can get kind of ridiculous if you massage that principle way too much. So it's a fun book. It really is. It's a good, I think I'm going to like that book a whole lot.
Now, what's your humor writing process? Because I like to talk things out. So when I come up with a new bit or I'm coming up with an idea, I usually just record myself just talking, blah, 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 out. And then I'll listen back to it and then I'll write it down. And do you like set time aside every day to write? Do you do that? Do you record and then go and write down stuff? Like, how does it work for you?
Well, I kind of, if I see something funny that happened, like a couple of days ago, I was at a wake. I know this is so inappropriate. I'm thinking of burying me with my pearls and tatas and all that. But I ran into a cousin of mine and I said, "You got something funny?" Like, and I always am just trying to absorb anything. He said, "Oh yeah. Now see, this could be a good story." And now this is where the humorous part of me comes in, because it's a story about some ancestors of mine down in Rockville, South Carolina, which is a beautiful spot. It's on the tip of Waddamalaw Island. I wouldn't say all that, right. But they hooked up the mule. And they wanted the mule to take them to the Presbyterian church. Now, further down was the Episcopal church, and they were members of the Episcopal church. But a freak storm came up, lightning came down, that mule got spooked and turned into the Presbyterian church. They could not get that mule to go one step further ever. So for 5 years, they went to the Presbyterian church. And then finally, they ended up back at their home Episcopal church. You know what happened? What? They got a new mule. So you see how that story, you can talk to a corporate group and say, do you need, change is tough. You know, this is how you segue it in. And some of y'all might need to get a new mule. And then people start, you know, so that's kind of how you, the process of taking something that's true, fluffing it up. And you could either do it, make it funny. If you could do it both ways, it would really be great. And that's what I try to do. Or you can do it as some kind of takeaway. So that's the way my brain thinks. And that's why I call my tagline Sweet Tea's Secret, Southern Fried Humor, because I want some sweet wisdom to be in there first, because that's important to me. And then I just don't want to be all ha-has, you know, and I can be, but I just feel like there's more to me that I want to share a little bit of wisdom.
Right. Luke?
I was wondering, do you have any like speakers that you look up to or authors that have like influenced you along your career?
Yeah, Jeannie Robertson. I don't know if you all know, but Jeannie is awesome.
We've been trying to get her on the podcast. Yeah. So if you know her and you can send her our way, we will love it.
Let me tell you something. She had me on her show from the back porch and immediately was 21,000 views. I mean, it's unbelievable. But see, Jeannie started out with Carl Hurley. He's from Kentucky, and they did this thing called Cavalcade of Comedy, and they were on Big Bus Tour. So Jeannie has a following. I mean, they love her. Yeah. I mean to tell you. And so she's doing live shows now. She's doing, I think, on the 3rd, she's got a show. And I call her about once a month, and we chat a little bit. I mean, try to. Yeah. And I try to keep up with her. She's so busy. Let me tell you her process. This is amazing to me. She gets up at 5 in the morning. She writes stories all day till 5 in the afternoon. That's what she does all day long. Because what Jeannie does is she flips her programs and her shows so she gets rebooked at the same theater every year. She packs them out. So I love Jeannie. Jeannie's amazing.
Yeah. I watch a lot of her stuff. She's amazing. Not only is she funny, but you always learn something from it. And you could like feel how much energy she has coming through a screen. Cause I watched her on YouTube and I was like, she's amazing. And we've been trying to get her on the podcast because she's just one of those people that you're like, I don't know how you do it. I have no clue how you do this. Cause everyone keeps telling us she's on tour all the time.
She is. And I mean, Jeannie wouldn't be ashamed if I told you, I think she's like 77 years old.
She doesn't look
so. No, and it's inspiring for someone to be able. And Jeannie always said, you grow with your people. And if you love this business, you will attract those people. You'll never outgrow speaking because you can always get, everybody can find their own audience. And they just follow you. So yeah, I love her. I love Irma Bombeck's stuff. I mean, she was so funny. And who is the girl? Savannah Lewis. She just wrote a book. You can't make this stuff up. And I started listening to her book, and that's how I wrote Sweet Tea Secrets. I said, darn it, if she can talk about Mississippi, I'll talk about South Carolina. So that's kind of how that came about. So, you know, creativity creates creativity. And right. And that's why it's been hard during COVID and the pandemic, because you're not with your creative crowd. I get the best ideas from my speaker buds and my funny buds, you know.
Yeah.
So that's why it's been kind of hard. But if you love it, you just keep working at it, I think. And I enjoy it thoroughly. I mean, when I can see somebody laugh, and boy, they were having a ball today. It was so fun. And they appreciated us coming out there, my friend and myself, who played the piano, and just singing and telling stories. And we worked hard on that show. And it was good. I thought it was good.
No, I'm sure. And man, so it sounds like you're busy too. What is the biggest, not secret, but if somebody was starting today, say Luke and I decided, hey, we want to follow in your footsteps. We want to do, you know, be a humorist where we go and do these kind of talks and stuff. What would be the secret or the message or the trick that you would share with us to say, hey guys, this is what you should be doing?
Well, the same advice that was given to me is to join the National Speakers Association and find your little group. And so like that's how I found my humor coach, Lou Heckler. His name is really Lou Heckler. He's so awesome. Funny. Listen, one of Jeannie's funniest bits is you don't bungee jump with a naked man. Do you remember that one?
Uh-huh, yes.
The very last line is, and I laughed so hard my water broke and I wasn't even pregnant. That is a Lou Heckler line. And Jeannie will tell you, Lou Heckler gave me that. But Jeannie comes up with incredible stuff. It's that last line. You know how hard that is to get. And sometimes you'll put a story aside and then you'll keep revisiting. And then finally, and then some words are funnier than others, you know.
Yep.
And I like to write parodies too. I like to, you know, like, I'm writing a song, a Sweet Tea song. It's going to be cute, but like I've written stuff like I'm a she, a Southern home executive, and I hit the bottle about getting old and wearing every kind of makeup you can imagine. So I just like to just entertain in any way I possibly can and really stretch myself. And don't be afraid of we've been rejected so many times. We're just used to it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I say the best 4-letter word in the English language is next.
That's so good.
People are really hungry. They want to be entertained more than ever. I think the people, when this thing plays out as best it can, I think the busiest people are going to be comedians, humorists, singers, all that. I tell you what, you watch, it's going to burst wide open.
what I've been telling a lot of comedians is get prepared to have restaurants want to have comedy in their restaurant, because they're going to need a reason. They're going to need something to get people to come back. And it's going to be hard just to say, yeah, we're open again. People are going to go, well, you already let me, you know, order out. So I'm just going to keep doing that. So it's going to have to be something. So I told comedians, get ready, get a show ready, get your stuff ready, because you're going to be able to go to restaurants, say, hey, I'd like to come do a show here every Friday, or I'd like to come do every Saturday, or what's your slowest night that you need to pick up on? Let's get, you know, some people in the door, whatever it is. And that's going to be the next big thing, because
I agree 100%. Yeah.
Yeah. People are starving for entertainment. I mean, I see it already. We've had people reach out to us to do Zoom shows. Like, look, can you guys come do this? Can you do that? And it's not, and I agree with you, it's not the same. The Zoom thing is like, it's so tough. It's so tough because it feels like I'm just talking to my computer and people can't really get back to me. Yeah.
So my son gave me this because I said, I hate Zoom meetings. They're so boring at times. So he gave me this. Well, that helps some.
You got a crowd. You got a crowd with you now.
Anything.
It's a fan. Yeah.
Yeah. I've been doing meetings. I've been, I did a dental group out in Seattle. But you know, I've been marketing and everything, but it's, my heart's not in it, 'cause I'm more of an in-person person.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. And it comes across, you know, more real, and you can feel that energy in person as opposed to Zoom, where, yeah, you can feel something, but it's not the same. It's, you're not getting the same feedback from the audience, and the audience isn't getting the same feeling from you. So it's very difficult.
Yeah. You can't feed each other.
Yeah.
You can't listen to the nuances of if the stuff is working or not.
Yeah.
And then a lot of people I noticed when I did that meeting in Seattle, they just had their little pictures up and they were busy cooking, or, I mean, I spent all this time putting graphics in, you know, it didn't matter.
So now that you're on your fifth book, when is that book supposed to come out?
Next year. I told those people, I said, I hope I'm not dead. I'm not a spring chick, but I said, and so, but I think they very wisely waited till the speaking schedule was going to get going. Right. And then that way I can promote it. And that's what I like to do. I think my books, and I would recommend, if anybody, just write a book and make it your calling card, because that's how you're going to get hired too. I mean, it's just a giant calling card. So that's how I've always positioned my books, and I've tried to sell them, and I've marketed and all that jazz, and any cash advance I've ever gotten, I just pour it right back in. So it's continuous. It really is. If you're going to be good in this business, and you just got to keep promoting, producing, and making yourself, you know, like, hey, y'all, don't forget me. I am out here. And I think that's what has happened with us during this time. We have to remind people we're here. And I cold call. I'm okay with that. Wow. But I've gotten so many fun conversations going with clients, you know, like my A-listers, that they just shut the door before. It's like, hey, I'm home. I said, what you doing? What's the weather? They're like, oh my gosh. Oh, Jane, we're going to put you on the list. The good list. I went good. So you just got to remind people where you are.
Yeah. Now you make me want to write a book. I've had two ideas for writing stories and books, so I might write a humorous book now. I was thinking about calling it West Coast Texan, because I'm from Texas, but I live out on the West Coast now. And there's just such a different world.
Yeah. Well, James, if you do, I got the right person to help you with it. I mean, I'm not trying to do a commercial, but this guy, he's the one that got me those big old contracts with that. Rhinestone book was Hachette. You know, that's a good one. That's one that made three majors. And because he is such a book guy, and he's so cheap, I keep telling him, you got to increase your fee. But he's gotten my friend's books number one on Amazon in their category, you know, and he's brilliant with books. So anyway, I'll help you with that.
All right. That's going to be awesome.
Yeah.
So what can we plug for you? What can we get people to, how can they check you out? How can they get to know you and get to see your stuff? Where's the best place?
Well, if you go to janeherlong.com, and if you want to download some free stuff, go to janeherlong.com/gift, G-I-F-T. And then you can download some comedy, listen to some serious stuff. And I think I have like Sirius XM stuff. And I think I have a couple of maybe a book or two, maybe just one book that you can download and just read and chuckle. Just to make people laugh a little bit, because gosh, y'all, we got to fight through all this negative stuff, and we got to give people some joy is really what we need to do. It's like a ministry for me.
Yeah.
Spread the joy.
I love that. Spread the joy. That should be a book of yours. That should.
There you go. Book
that's a title
six.
Right there. There you go. Spread some joy. That's, you know, because that's what we really need. Like, this has been hard. This has been the hardest year that I can remember for anybody, for my kids, for my family, like everyone that I know. And so, yeah, spread that joy. That's amazing. Luke, do you have anything to ask?
My book is going to be, is it 2022 yet? I'll start working on it tonight.
We're all waiting for that. But you know, when you create a speech in your mind, think of a good friend. Like, I grew up on a tomato farm. So my signature speech is called "Don't Throw Tomatoes at My Field of Dreams."
Oh, I like
and
that.
And I think of the three principles I learned in the tomato farm and on working on the farm with my daddy. And they're common sense things. And then there's got little Southern funny stories laced around it. So that's kind of how you can take your business from comedy and using some of these life lessons and stories and tuck them in there. And so then you got a really good speech and associations gobble those puppies up.
Yeah, that's great. I love it. All right. Luke, where can people find you at, sir?
Luke LaCoy, just on the socials.
All right. You can check me out, jamesdcrefson.com, or you can go to comedypreneur.com. And I have a good tagline that I got that I wrote. It's called turn your funny into money. And I think that like is exactly what you are preaching, right? Is exactly what to do.
Yeah. And repurpose it as much as you can. Wring it out till it's dry. Just get it going. You can do all kinds of fun stuff with it. And it really is blessing to people. Really, it really is.
Yeah. Making people laugh, there is no better feeling in the world. And then I'm sure you've had it too, where people leave and they go, you know what? I really needed that. Thank you so much. You know, and that there's no better feeling than that, honestly.
I'm telling you, and I don't mean to, you know, a friend of mine was doing a program and there was a woman on the front row and she just had no expression. And afterwards she came up to her and said, that was the greatest speech because I just lost my child. And I just, for the first time I've been out, I don't mean to be morbid about it, but a lot of people have a lot of hurts and we can't see those hurts. And when someone tells you something like that, you are just like, wow, this is why I'm doing what I'm doing.
I love it. That's exactly right. That's exactly why we do it. Is we want to make the world a better place through humor. That's our gift. That's the thing that we can do for other people. So yeah. I'm so grateful for people like you. I'm so grateful that we have a gift like that we can all share. And humor is a great healing tool. My grandma always told me that. She always said, you know, if you can make people laugh whenever they're down, that's special. That's something that God gave you, that's special. So
well, it's biblical. I say this in my speeches, a merry heart doeth good like a medicine, but a crushed spirit will dry your bones.
That's the truth.
Yeah. It's a proverb.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, thank you so much. Thank you again for being on the podcast. Luke, thank you for coming and being my co-host. And thank you, everybody, for listening. Please like, subscribe, and please go check out Jane, and please go to her site and get the free gifts and enjoy her humor, because I'm telling you right now, we need it, and she's amazing, and you're going to love it. So thank you again. Have a great one, everybody, and bye.